your way up to the front as we cover the bases on these things. And as you're doing so, I've got a couple that I need to touch base on. One, we have found some earrings. Any of you ladies that have lost earrings, if you'll would like to come and identify them, you may have them.
They're just not my style. Got the wrong initial. Sir?
Would it make fishing lures?
No.
No.
But anyway, if any of you ladies over the last, we've had them for some time. I don't know what that equals to, but if you've lost some over the past few months or years, you can try to claim those. We also have an announcement for a floating bridal shower. Must be held on a boat. Floating. For Marley Futrell and Kyle Darden. Did I pronounce that correctly? I hope. Saturday, March the 25th from 3 till 5 at the Fountain Town Community Center. And they are registered at Walmart, Bed Bath & Beyond, and Target. So if you're interested, please participate in that, okay? And also, I got a little letter from the Children's Home just thanking Bethlehem Church for being one of the larger donors to the Children's Home Ministry. This particular note did not request no funds. They were just thanking you for being a supporter of the Children's Home, and that came from Gary Lee himself, so and Carrie Brown. So do keep that in mind, and thank you for the support of that particular ministry. I also want to remind you that tomorrow night at 7 o'clock we'll be having a joint meeting of the buildings, the Building Project Committee and our General Board to kind of dive a little bit deeper into the process and as we're moving forward on that. So keep that in mind, and I hope that you can make plans to attend. If you're on these two committees, you if you can, please make a point to be here. I'll be glad to make sure that there's a bottle of water for everybody, and that's your incentive to come. But anyway, do come and be a part of that if you will, and I know the Lord will bless you for that. And we're going to go ahead and let the others make their announcements. We'll start, Ms. Diane, would you like to come share that which is on your mind?
Okay, ladies, I just want to remind all of you about our Ladies' Day event that we're having on April the 1st. We are looking forward to everybody being here. We're getting excited about it. And it starts at 10 o'clock. Our theme for the day is Amazing Grace for a Woman's Heart. Cheryl Fountain, Kenny Fountain's wife from Cedar Fork, will be our guest speaker that day, and we have some music lined up, praise and worship. So we want all of you to come, stay for lunch. Tickets are $8 per person. That helps pay for the meal. And I do have tickets today. You can see me after church for those. Bring your friends. I have sent flyers out to some of our neighboring churches, so some of those ladies know about it as well. If you have any questions, you can just see me or Carol or Rita, and I hope to see all of you here. We will not have a nursery that day, men, stay home and help your wife that day and keep your children. It's be a good daddy children day, or your grandchildren, anyway. Hope to see you. Okay, and men, you need to come to Men Up on Tuesday nights at 8 o'clock. And ladies, make sure you stay home and you keep your children that night. That's a good mom and children day night, so your husbands, boyfriends, significant others can come out to Men Up.
There's a common thread there, isn't it? Kind of helpful, yeah. Okay, that was good. Tiffany, you want to come? Sure.
So apparently I have an announcement this morning. I was just handed this flyer, and apparently I'm heading this up this year. It is that time of year again for the 5K at the Children's Home. So if you want to run or if you want to walk, we encourage you to participate in this event. This is the fifth 5K that the Children's Home has hosted. I can speak from personal experience that it is a wonderful time. And I will probably say this every year, don't eat a cheddar bow before you run, okay? doesn't end like you want it to. So that's going to be on May the 6th. We are going to do what we did last year. We're going to try to get a group of people together before that deadline because the registration is going to be cheaper that way. So I've set the deadline for April the 9th. I'm going to have this information in the back next Sunday where you can fill it out. The registration price for each runner, if we turn it in ahead of time, will be $15. If you register that day, it will be $30. So there's a big difference there. If you are not able to pay and you would like to participate, please let me know as soon as possible so I can line up getting sponsors for everyone. So you're going to be seeing me up here until April the 9th. Any questions? Everyone can walk, right? You don't have to run. So this is a good way to participate, not only fellowship with our church, but also benefit a really great ministry. Did I forget anything? Oh, we're going to meet at the church at 6 a.m. that morning because we're going to stop and get a biscuit. But don't get a cheddar bun.
Yeah, I just want to know where the bleachers are for us that want to cheer.
You can walk.
I like the idea of the bleacher, though.
But you lead the way. You're leading the way for everyone.
As long as they're walking, I'll lead the way.
Yes. You
okay. Can. Let's not get walk into the out. Running for 5 miles. I will not. Oh, three. Well, that's okay, too. You got an announcement?
I do.
Would you like to share?
If you don't mind. I have a couple announcements. The first is concerning the youth convention that Miranda spoke about last week. Those dates are May the 19th through the 21st, and that is the youth convention that is held on the campus of Mount Olive University. And we have had youth express a desire to go this year. Any child 8 and under will need a parent chaperone to go with them. But our youth group as a whole will be going. But we do need a count. So if you are interested in going that weekend, the boys stay in one dorm and the girls stay in another. And it's very well chaperoning. There's activities for the weekend and a great speaker also that will be speaking to the youth. The cost per child is about $70, and our church is going to cover the cost if you're a member of our youth group. But if you would like to sponsor a child to go and help cover some of the cost, I'm sure that they would gladly accept that. So, like I said, the cost is about $70 per child, and that's for their T-shirt, that's for the whole weekend, that's feeding them and everything. So, and if you're a parent and you would just like to go up for the day, you can do that on Saturday, but we also need to know that. We need that count. So we really need that within probably the next week or so that we can make reservations. So be thinking about that and see Miranda or Caleb, either one, on that. The other thing is the dinner that I spoke about last week. It's on March the 31st. That's on a Friday. And it is a fundraiser to benefit Rachel Parker Denning. And she is she has cancer and is undergoing treatment. She's also a school teacher at Dixon High School. And Crandall will be delivering plates that day. And I have volunteered to pick plates up from him and come deliver them to anybody that wants one for that day. The cost is $7, and it's barbecue and slaw and hush puppies and I think baked beans. I think it is, or green beans one. Anyway, and a dessert for $7. There is a sign-up sheet out in the vestibule, so if you would write your name and telephone number and let me know how many plates you would like, I will be glad to deliver them to you. And that is the 31st of March.
Anyone else have an announcement? Okay, this coming Thursday night, the senior meal, fellowship time together. So we hope that you'll make plans to come and be a part of that. That's always a good evening. They do a good job, and I'm sure this week will be no difference. That's at 6 o'clock, and there's always a good devotion, a message that is brought, as well as music. So we hope that you'll take advantage of that and come and be a part of that, if you will. Any others? If not, y'all ready to sing? Y'all still thinking about that?
Well, we're going to sing two songs up front. One of them you know very well. The other you're familiar with. Probably more so than I, so I'm going to need your help. So y'all ready? God is so good. Let's stand and sing together. God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me. He cares for me. He cares for me. He cares for me. He's so good to me. Week following, will you make a commitment that you will continue to praise his name? So let's kind of reword it a little bit. And instead of saying, let's sing, I'll praise his name. So going forward, let me make a commitment today that we're going to praise God in the midst of our valleys as well as the mountaintops. So let's sing that little bit again. I'll praise his name. may be seated. Some beautiful words to that song. At this time, as we go to the Lord in prayer, we do want to remember those that's on our prayer list. We also want to remember Warren Sloan. He's in the hospital and has been for the last couple of days with some issues, but I think he's doing much better. The message that we spoke with Pam just a little bit, he is doing much, much better. So do keep him in your prayers. We will also, the Reverend Buddy Sasser, keep him in prayers as well, and continue to lift him up. Remember our church, the building program, and all the different bits and pieces that the Lord will bless and be a part of that. And it's so do keep that, all of these, in prayer. But there might be others, outspoken requests at this time to be mentioned. We're going to start here on my left. Is there any requests for prayer? Yes, ma'am. Any others? Yes, ma'am. Nicole.
My husband Jeremy. Yeah.
Yes. And the family. That's yes. Absolutely. Yes, Dan.
Our Any
others? Also remember the family of Ashley Brinkley's grandmother passed, I believe. Keep that family in prayer. Yes?
John Williams?
Yes. Yes, Mr. Simpson?
Yes. Also, the mother had a tumble in the floor Friday morning. I was in the back room there, and I heard some bumping going on. And she was laying out there on the floor, kind of glasses, they were a black eye and a busted lip, and I was huge trying to break that.
Rosen.
Stephen Gerganis, he had an accident a couple of weeks ago. I remember him and Curtis Hansley. He's a young husband and father with cancer.
Precious.
In stage 4.
Britt. Any others? Yes. Okay. Yes. Okay. Caleb? Okay. Well, let's Charles, if you would come and pray. Any others? Levi? Yes, sir. Your mom is back. Any others? Let's keep all of these in our hearts as we pray together.
Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for all the blessings you've given us. Thank you, Lord, for keeping us safe in hard times and giving us something that we can look toward to for hope. Bless all the people that are sick, Lord. Bless the people that are going away on deployment and protecting us. And give them strength and give them all guidance. And we thank you for that, Lord, and we thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
At this time, we'll continue our worship together and our opportunity. We don't have to give. We get to. And just keep that in the back of your mind as we have an opportunity to worship our Lord in our tithes and our offerings. Don't ask the ushers to come as we worship together at this time. Ushers.
Let us pray. But Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your love, for your many blessings. And Lord, we thank you we have the opportunity to come to your house and worship today. Lord, for the ones who are not here today because of sickness, they should be with them. Lord, just help them to have better days as their doctors and nurses and ministers to them. Give us now as we come to part of this being here today that we give what's rightfully yours, Lord. Bless this offering. It may be used in the lifting of your kingdom. In your name we pray. Amen.
Why don't you get up and now and spend some time and just greet one another in the name of the Lord. And you might even want to give somebody a hug. I don't know. Somebody might need a hug. So share as the choir comes forward and children's church can be dismissed as well.
Susan began this morning by playing a tune, "I'm So Glad I'm a Part of the Family of God." It's amazing to me how the Spirit just, I didn't tell her to play that, but the Spirit orchestrates things at times to bring it together. The song that you all sang, "Jesus, What a Friend for Sinners," was impressed upon me this morning as I sat back there trying to prepare for the service this morning and thinking about the choir's song and what song would set the stage for what the choir is, the message in music this morning. And then Susan played, "I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God." And I'm glad this morning that I'm a member of God's family and that you all are my brothers and sisters. I stand up here to confess that I'm not perfect, and you all know that. Some of you more than others. But you all still love me, even when I mess up. And you encourage me, and I see you all encouraging one another as sometimes one of us will stumble and fall as God's children. God is so good. We sung that chorus. He is so good to you and to me. And we're here today to praise his name because of his love and mercy and grace that he just bestows on us every day. "Jesus, what a friend for sinners. Jesus, lover of my soul. Friends may fail me, foes may assail me. He, my Savior, makes me whole. Jesus, I do now receiving more than all in him I find. He hath granted me forgiveness. I am his, and he is mine." I encourage you to open the hymn book and look at all the verses of that and just ponder on them, reflect upon just how much God loves us. Listen to the choir song this morning. The title is "Orphans of God." And the message is there are no orphans. We're God's children. And we may stumble and fall in our lives. There's not a one of us, if I was to ask for anyone who is a professing Christian to stand, if you haven't sinned since you have professed Christ as your Savior, no one could truthfully stand. We've all messed up. But God still loves us. And his love, mercy, and grace is still there. He's such a friend for us sinners like you and me.
You hear my
had today that God receives us all. Today, as we turn our attention, this message, it's one of those things where God has led me back to this message. I've preached it a number of times, and for some reason, I normally mark where and when I preach certain messages, and I don't know if I've preached this one here or not. So I kind of feel like the preacher that went to a new church, and the first Sunday he preached a very dynamic message, and everybody was just thrilled. And the next Sunday came around, he preached the same message, and still dynamic, but they kind of scratched their head and went on. And third Sunday came around, he preached the same message. Fourth Sunday came around, he preached the same message again. And finally, the deacons, as they came out the door, said, "Preacher, that's a good message, but don't you have anything else?" And the preacher said, "Yeah." He said, "When you start living this one, I'll go to the next one." Not quite, but so if you have your Bibles, turn with us to Revelation chapter 6. I think, again, I don't want you to get caught up into as soon as somebody, a pastor, a preacher, a teacher, asks you to open up to Revelation, automatically we begin to unfold before us all of these prophetic things. And certainly so, because there's a lot of it here in the book of Revelation. But I believe that the book of Revelation is given to us not only that we might understand a little bit about what God has coming down the road and what the future might look like and how our destiny may end, but also it gives to us a vastness of the glory of God, the Christ that came to set us free, and the things that he's going to do in order to restore his creation from the very beginning. And in the midst of that, in Revelation chapter 6, to give you a context as we jump into the opening of these seals, in chapter 5, we find that there was a search that took place that would be worthy, first of all, to open up the books, the judgments of God, and all of these things that were taking place. And remember, God's people are crying out for deliverance. God's people are crying out for God to do something to deliver them from all that's taken place. And in the midst of this, no one was found worthy in heaven or on earth to open up the seals. And John the Baptist, John on the Isle of Patmos, he was heartbroken. The Bible says he wept. He didn't know what to do. No one was found worthy to open up the book. So what in the world are you going to do? And one of the elders said, "Wait a minute, John, don't get too upset, because here comes the Lamb of God, the Lion of the tribe of Judah." As he was crucified, as he was sacrificed from the very foundation of the world, he has come and he is worthy. Only he is worthy. So he begins to open up these things. And chapter 6 is the beginning of that. Chapter 6 is the beginning of Christ beginning to open up all of the things that were taking place. And there are a number of good books out there that if you want to get into the diciness and the very meat and some of the details of all of this, some several good books out there I can highly recommend to you. One of them is by Billy Graham, the Approaching Hoofprints, Hoofbeats, that's it. That's a very good one. David Jeremiah has one. Also, Escape the Coming Night. These are very good books that you can read, and I highly recommend you might want to do so if you want to look more along the lines of prophecy. That's not my position here today, but I want to show to you the love of God. As we talk about being the family of God, I want to show to you what one of the instances and one of the driving points behind prophecy, and I hope that you'll get it before we leave here today. The book of Revelation can be broken down real simple. And this is a guideline that you can follow. You can look at it. It breaks it down pretty simple. Chapter 1, Revelation deals with what John saw. that which he seen coming down as he was taken away in the spirit, as God done these things and began to reveal to him. Chapter 1 is kind of revealing what John saw. And chapters 2 and 3 shows us a little bit about what things are like, what they are now in the midst of the churches. And we know that in the context of chapters 2 and 3, we have the letters to the seven churches and dealing with the issues and the good things of the church and the faults and the failures of the church. And then in chapters 4 and 5, we can see that God's throne room is revealed. And all of the essence and all of the glory of God's throne is shown forth in chapters 4 and 5. And then in chapters 6 through 19, God deals with his wrath. All of the judgments, all the things that he said he would do in chapter 6 through 19, God reveals all of these things. And then in chapters 20 and 22, as it closes out this particular book, sets the stage for where we will be in the New Jerusalem. So that kind of breaks down the book of Revelation for you if you want to go look at it in that context. And in the midst of that, as we see all of these things portraying, Revelation is about one simple fact. God wins. Yeah. We win. Yeah, that's what the Bible teaches us. Here in chapter 6, we see the opening scene, if you will, the very beginnings of some horrific times on the face of the earth. This is one of those times to where and my brother and I have argued this point. We don't argue as much anymore because we don't see each other as often, but we have, even on telephone calls, somehow or another, we get directed into this. He's one of those mid-tribulationist dudes that think the rapture of the church don't take place until the middle of the tribulation. I'm a pre-tribulation. I believe the church is going to be taken out. It's like I've told him many times before. If I'm wrong, I'll get a second chance. If he's wrong, he don't. But anyway, in the process of this, in this very context, if we are going to be mid-tribulationists, you're going to see these things. My Bible tells me that if you're redeemed, we are therefore. We have been redeemed. We have been set apart. Our price has been paid that we will not suffer these things. There are no condemnation, the Bible says, to them what? Which are in Christ. So if that's true, why would we go through these things? That's just, you can kind of, I won't charge you nothing for that one. In Revelation chapter 6, verse 1, it says, "And when I saw the Lamb open one of the seals, and I heard as it were a number or a noise of thunder." And I really believe that God's judgment is going to be announced in a way that the whole world will know God's coming. If you're on Facebook, I titled today's message, "These Horses Are Coming." And I believe with all of my heart that God's coming. His plan is going to be revealed. And in the midst of this is the thunder sounds. One of the four beasts saying, "Come and see." And I saw, behold, a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow. A crown was given unto him, and he went forth conquering and to conquer. And we're going to take this section by section instead of reading the whole context, but we're going to get to it through verse 8, I believe it is. As we look at these first couple of verses, the very first horse that is seen is a white horse, and he that sat upon him had a bow. Now, some of the commentaries you may read and some of those that you may talk to kind of identifies this individual as Christ because of the connection with being white and all of these things. But I want to show to you that it's not Christ that is sitting on this white horse. Do not confuse this white horse with the one in Revelation chapter 19. They're two totally different things. And I want you to note that the Bible is pretty specific here. The Bible said that this white horse and he that sat upon the white horse had a bow. Now, I don't know how many archery people we got here. You may beat somebody to death with a bow, but the lethal part of a bow is the arrow. That's where the danger of a bow comes in. There is no mention of any arrows given to this horseman. And any time, now you may not think that's such a big deal, but as you go back and look through the Old Testament text, any time that you see a man of war, any time you see someone going into battle with a bow, he has arrows. There is not a single instance when someone is going into confrontation in Bible and Old Testament text that they go into battle with just a bow. They always have their arrows. I think it's significant and it's important for us to understand that this individual comes into battle to do battle without arrows. In other words, it's going to be a battle of words with him. This is none other, I believe, as I look into and my study has come about, and you can disagree with me, want to, and we can go to Cracker Barrel later. But I believe that this is the Antichrist that is sitting on this horse. The Antichrist, I believe, will come on the scene. If you look around in the world today, who are we looking for? We're looking for somebody. The most popular word being used in media today is unified. Everybody you talk to, oh, we got to unify. We got to come together. We got to unify our thoughts and everything. The world is looking for a worldly leader that will unify. And I think that this is going to come about through the words, through contracts, through negotiations in order to bring about, quote, peace that we may coexist on the face of this earth. I don't think it's going to be done necessarily by military might, but it's going to be done on the tables of negotiation. This is why this horseman, I believe, comes in the midst of all this taking place with just a bow. He's given a crown. This is a conqueror's crown. This is a crown that more than likely is made out of some of the irons or some of the brass that's made around, or it might even be a crown made out of leaves and thorns, not thorns, but out of the ivory leaves that was existent in those days, that was given to him to identify him as the leader. He's not wearing a kingly royal crown. Jesus in chapter 19 is wearing a king's crown. Big difference. He has a bow here in chapter 6, and the one in chapter 19, he has a diadem. He's a ruler. He's a king. That's our Lord. This is the Antichrist. And that word anti, if you look at it, is simply, in basic terms, means opposite. Everything, you see, Satan is a great imitator. He's not original on nothing. He imitates everything that God has done. He tries to imitate it. If Christ is the bread of life, Satan is death. If Christ is love, then Satan is hatred. Whatever Christ is, the Antichrist is the opposite. And we need to understand that in the midst of what the Antichrist has come to do is to bring about a unity, because in just a moment we're going to see why that's such important, in order to bring about a conquering spirit. In the midst of this, as we see in verse 3, and there's many things we can go in, and for the sake of time, we'll move on. I do not want y'all to get too spoiled being getting out early last Sunday. We want to continue the tradition. Verse 3. Verse 3 says, "And when he had opened the second seal, I heard a second beast say, 'Come and see.' And there went out another horse that was red in power, was given," listen to the words, they mean things, "was given to him that sat thereon to take peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another. And there was given to him a great sword." In the process of this, the second horse that comes about is a red horse, signifying death, signifying that it was a death of battle. Now, notice what takes place. We have the Antichrist in verses 1 and 2, and then we come here and we find in verses 3 and 4, we have another creature sitting upon a red horse, and I want you to note, he does not get into battle. He is not the one doing the fighting. He is in the midst of it. What does he do? He takes peace away. And when you remove peace, what happens? You have chaos. You have war. And in the midst of this, as peace has been removed, and they began, the Bible in verse 4, it says they should kill one another. So this began to take place when peace is removed from a peaceful situation that we have negotiated in verses 1 and 2. Peace is removed, all chaos, and then war breaks out, and people began to kill and take out one another. This is a part of the judgment of God upon a sinful world. In the process of this, we find that as this horseman comes on the scene, all of this peace that is taken away, the killings and all that it would be, that horse symbolizes the shedding of blood, that red horse. In the midst of this, we also see that he, in the midst of taking peace, he steals people's joy. And when people have no peace and no joy, that's a miserable place to be. A lot of evil things begin to rise. The third one, moving on in verse 5, it says there, "And when he had opened the third seal, he heard the third, and he said, Come and see. And I beheld, and lo, a black horse. And he that sat on him had a pair of balances, weights, in his hands. And it says in verse 6, it said, I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts saying, A measure of wheat for a penny, three measures of barley for a penny, and see thou hurt not the oil and the wine." Now, one of the things that follows war, when a place is decimated and war has come through a region, the next thing that happens is famine. In the midst of this, basically what this text is telling us is that a day's worth of food is going to cost you a day's salary for one person. Now, just think about that for just a moment. Your salary for one day to buy food for you for one day. It doesn't take a mathematician to tell you you can't survive that way. Because that home, that person bringing in the money, if you have enough to buy food for one day for yourself, you come home and you have three children looking at you and a wife, and you got to divide what was for one by four. Desperate times will come. Now, I want you to note, in the midst of this, as the famine begins to hit the land, begins to take place, it says here, hurt not the oil and the wine. In the midst of the times that this was written, we need to understand that those that had wealth, they had oil and wine. That symbolizes the wealth and the riches. The barley and the wheat were those that were poor, those that were of the marketplace. See the picture? Hurt not the oil and wine. The poor is going to get hit hard. But don't be too hasty here, because those that are living off of the oil and wine will get their day at another time. But understanding today, when we begin to talk about, we all know about the mark of the beast, we know about all of these things, and we've heard talk of one world governments, and it's just amazing to me the things that have changed just in the last 10 years. I can remember 30 years ago hearing preachers preach about one world governments and reading books about this thing and all of this that takes place in the mark of the beast, and you're sitting here thinking, well, how in the world is all this going to take place? But look around you today. Being a one world government is not that far off. When you begin to look at what's happening to currency around the world, government after government is beginning to take paper money off the market. When you don't have money, desperate times comes. And I don't know how many of you here could look at your family and see they're starving to death, would not succumb to the pressure in order to do business, in order to do anything in the marketplace. You're going to have to take the mark of this one world government. It's going to be a terrible time. Moving on. There's good news at the end of this, trust me. In verse 4, in verse 7, it says, the last seal that is opened at this particular time, he says that when the fourth seal is open, and when he had opened it, he said, the beast, come and see. In verse 8, it says, and I looked, and behold, a pale horse. And notice this is the only horse, the only one that is named. The rest of them are unnamed. This one, his name that sat on him was Death. And hell followed with him. and power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth to kill with sword, with hunger, with death, and with the beasts of the earth. The massive killing off of people, one fourth of mankind that is left and remaining will be taken out. That's a lot of people. Because when you remove the some estimated number of Christian people, when the rapture takes place and God's people are called home, you're still going to be left with a tremendous amount of people on the face of the earth. And this one seal, this one judgment is going to take a fourth of them out. By different means, by famine, by the sword, by war. And hell is following. Some writer I read, and I forgot who it was, I'm thinking it's one of David Jeremiah's writings, that death serves as a vacuum cleaner. That hell serves as a vacuum cleaner for death in these times. Just gathering up all those souls that rejected Christ. What a sad day. And these are the times, these are things that are yet to come. And as we share these things, I also want you to understand that these things are put here for our benefit. We have an opportunity today to do something about this. If you're here today and you fear these things, if you sit in dread of all of these things that are mentioned here, you need to understand that Jesus has come and gave his life that you don't have to be there. He has shed his blood to offer to you forgiveness of your sin, that you will escape the coming wrath of God. Those that remain that are rejecting of Christ, that those that do not want to share the love of God, these things are for them, not for the child of God. Again, Vern, I'm glad I'm part of the family of God. I don't have to fear these things. So if these things are in place, if there's any good that we can glean from this, I want to hit three things right quickly that our response ought to be to all of these plagues and the epidemics and all the killing and all of the wrath of God that is to come. There should be three basic responses that we should offer. One, we ought to offer praise to the one true God. The God of Abraham and Jacob and Isaac, not the God of money, not to the God of the Hindus or the Buddhists or the Islamics, whoever you want to claim, but to the one true God. To offer praise to him, for he is worthy. He is worthy of our praise and all that we have to offer. He is worthy of our obedience. He's worthy of the voices that we shout in Hosanna. He's worthy of our worship and to know. Look, there's a picture. I wasn't going to go there, but there's a picture in the Old Testament that Elijah wanted to see God. He wanted to see him face to face. And God said, that's not going to happen. He said, but look, I'll tell you what I will do. He set him off on the cliff of the rock. And he hid him underneath the cliff. And God said, look, I'm going to pass by you. And I'll put my hand over your eyes so that you'll not see my face and my glory. And when I passed by, he removed his hand. And Elijah seen the backside of God. That's the closest that Elijah could come to the glory of God. We can't lay our face on the face of God without dying. It's important to know that we do not stand in righteous place to stand in the presence of God. But God said that through my son, you can be imputed, you can be given righteousness, that one day you'll stand in my presence. So we can glorify the one true God. That ought to be our response, to know that God has given to us a plan, to know that he has set forth for us to experience victory. Give him praise in his house today. Will you do that? Praise the Lord. That ought to be our first response, is to praise the one true God. The second response we ought to have is a passion for him. A passion. If we believe God, if we believe that Jesus is the only begotten Son of God, sent from the glories of heaven to hang on the cross, to spend time 3 days in a borrowed tomb, to be raised again and to be resurrected, to be taken to heaven, and today intercedes for you and I. He is our heavenly cheerleader. If you believe that today, then we ought to receive and we ought to respond with passion. We ought to be willing to wear the t-shirt. We've got Carolina fans and Duke fans and State fans and all kinds of fans that, man, that they'll wear the t-shirts, the toboggan, the socks, the rings, you name it, they'll put it on and they'll wear it because they're passionate about it. We ought to be just as passionate about God. We ought to be just as passionate about what Jesus has done for us. Our response to know that we're going to miss this. As a child of the living God, as an orphan of God, we're going to miss this. And we ought to serve Him with the passion that He is due. We ought to serve Him with the passion in our heart that we would give all that we have for His glory. That we'd be willing to say, God, where are you going to send me? I'll go. Whatever you want me to do, I'll do, because we're going to serve you with passion. We're going to instill within us the same passion that we have for things that will have passion for you. The same passion that we have for our hobbies we'll put into your stead. We'll have that same passion for God. The same passion that we have for our food we'll put towards God. We love to eat, don't we, Baptist? Amen. We love to eat. And we're going to give that same passion because of that same hunger that dwells in our heart for God. We're going to have that same passion that we might be filled with the presence of God. We're going to have the same passion about God as we do for things that we tell people about. If you're passionate about something, you tell people about it. It don't take long to find out people's passion, whether it's guns or music, whether it's cars or whether it's sewing or whether it's whatever it is. It don't take long to find out people's passion. Just spend a few moments in conversation and it comes out. Unfortunately, we have a tendency to hide our passion for God. And we need to come out of the closet as God's children, as His orphans, as His family. And we need to come out of our closets and serve Him with passion that others might see the love of God flowing through us, that it doesn't stop in us, but it flows through us, that the world around us might know the joy of the Lord. We ought to serve Him with a tremendous passion. Ought to be our response to know that God done all of these things, that we'll not have to suffer these kinds of things. I'm glad that God gave us a plan that I don't have to look in my family's eyes and know they're starving to death because of our stance for God. He's told us, if you'll believe in my Son and if you'll receive Him into your heart and confess Him as Lord today, I'm not going to be ashamed of you. I will call you up and catch you up into the air, and there will you be with me for all eternity. My friends, we ought to serve God with a tremendous amount of passion for what He's done for us. Amen. We ought to praise Him. We ought to be passionate for Him. And we need to understand our position in Him. All of these things, you can't buy it. You can't earn it. I was watching a testimony of a guy that he's one of these bodybuilders. He's got muscles where people don't think muscles ought to be, you know. He flexes and them big old balls, you know, just up there. But he's a Christian. And he began to tell his testimony. He began to share about the things. He began to understand that sometimes you've got to put forth the effort. He said, but he began to realize that it didn't matter how many times he picked up his Bible. It didn't matter how many times he went to church. It was only when he realized that Jesus needs to be in his heart that he began to build spiritual muscle. That he began to realize that his place in the kingdom is not just to look good and sound good and be good, but his position in the kingdom was about him believing in Jesus Christ as his Lord and his Savior. You need to understand that position today. It don't matter what your name is. When you stand before God and He opens up the book of life, He's going to flip through those pages, and the only name that counts is the one that's recorded there. The one that is paid in full by the blood of the Lamb. That's the name that counts. If your name is not there, it don't matter where it's at. You can belong to every civic group from here to California. But if your name is not in the Lamb's Book of Life, you're not in the position you need to be.
You may be the president of the largest bank in America. But if you're not a child of the living God, you're going to stand on the same ground as these folks. Know your position today. If you're here and you never professed the Lord as Savior, you're in a bad position. I'm just going to be honest with you. I don't know if anybody's been truthful with you about this before, but I'm just going to lay it out for you real simple. If you're here today and you never professed the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you're headed to bust hell wide open. And regardless of what the world may think, it is not going to be a place of partying and celebration. It's going to be a painful, horrible place. And if you're here today and you don't know Christ as your Savior, you need to come to Him today. You're not promised tomorrow. The Bible says that today is the day of salvation. You need to come today. If you're here today as a child of God and you've got loved ones that you know that are lost, and the invitation is given in just a few moments, you need to find your way here and use this altar for God. Look, somewhere in our ego, somewhere in our minds, we've got this thing to think that coming to the altar is for people that are hurting. Yes, it is. For people that are lost, and yes, it is. But somehow we have put a stigma on it that if I go to that altar, somebody might talk about me. Let me give you one little piece of advice. If that's all they've got to talk about, let them talk. If you need to come to this altar, God's waiting for you. God's people are waiting to pray with you. The choice is yours. We've got good news. We win. The horse that are coming with all of their pain, with all of the defeat, with all of the bloodshed and all the loss of life and all of that stuff. Jesus said, don't worry about it. You're with me. You're with me. Are you? Do you know Jesus is your Savior today? I want to ask the pianist to come, and I want to ask you, if you will, just stand right where you are. And as she plays, deal with your heart. With every head bowed and every eye closed for just a moment, we're going to have a short prayer. And of course, the altar is open. You can come at any time. But at this moment in time, you have an opportunity to realize that, yes, I'm a sinner, and I need Jesus in my life, and you can come. Maybe you have backslid and you know that you're not in the right place. You're not positioned with Christ the way you ought to. Why don't you come? In Jesus' name we pray. Lord, that every voice would be heard today. Lord, that the person in the Holy Spirit would work in the midst of the lives of those that are here, that you would convict them of their sins. Lord, that you would comfort them to know that you are here for them, to extend to them the offer of forgiveness of all of their sins, if they would just come and believe. Father, for those that remain, those that love you, those that serve you, they're burdened, they're struggling, hear their prayer. In Jesus' name. Will you come today? In the stillness and the quietness of this hour, will you hear the voice of God speaking to you? That nervousness you may feel, the temperature may have kicked up a notch or two, that just may be a symptom that God's dealing with your heart and that you need to come. And my prayer is that God would send an unease in your life. That until you humble yourself
the realization that you are a sinner, that you would come. Come on the behalf of that loved one that you know that is lost, and lift them up before the Lord. In Jesus' name, we present those that have come. Father, whatever is upon their heart, whatever the need may be, we ask you, Father, that you would touch them, Lord, in the very point of their need the most. Lord, if it's a loved one that they're praying for, we ask you, Lord, that your spirit would go forth and render the service, Lord, that person, that they would feel that conscious pull away from their sin. Lord, for the lonely heart, for those that are grieving, for those that are searching, we pray, Father, your hand upon them today. We thank you for being God, for loving us, for caring for us. And we pray, Lord, this day, that our lives will be a shining example every day, that others can see Christ through us, that through that which you have given us, Lord, we might be able to save some lost soul, rescuing them from the pit of hell, covering a multitude of sin. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask if you will. You can be seated for just a moment, if you will. I've got a special event. I hope this becomes a long-lasting tradition that Bethlehem can adopt and continue. And you may have done this in the past, but I hope that this is something that will continue. They don't know about this, so... I'm going to ask Vince and Kendall, would you come join me up here, please? Don't be afraid. It's okay.
It will make you feel small.
Yeah, that's so good. I appreciate that. We have come to love these two right here, the work they do and the love they have for each other, for God, and for this church. It's tremendous. Most of you know that Vince will be deploying soon. I don't know exactly when yet, but soon. And before he left, like I said, I hope this becomes a tradition. As military families come into our presence, we've got a family here with the husband deployed, and we just don't know when they're going to come and bless us with their presence, and when we have to let them go for a little while. And in so doing, times like this, I think, should be celebrated. They ought to be recognized. And they ought to know that we love them. Amen? We do need to let them know that. And on behalf of the church, we do have a gift for Vince as he deploys. And hope that you can use that as you go on your way. And just know that we love you. And we're going to try our best to look after that girl while you're gone. That's not all. We've also barbecued a pig, and we're going to have a fellowship dinner in the fellowship hall, so y'all have a moment to come and talk to these guys and let them know that you love them. But before we dismiss, I want to ask the deacons, if you would, to come, and we want to lay hands on this man. I believe that God can protect and guide the steps of those that are directed. And I believe that laying on the hands of this young man as he goes forth and serves our country is needed. Not only to let him know that we love him, but to let him know that as this day as we gather around him, to lay hands upon him, to let him know that we're going to be praying for you every day.
Yes.
Every day we'll be praying. Guys, would you gather around and lay hands upon this brother and his wife as a church, to send them off with all the love that we can muster. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you on behalf of Vince and Kendall, Lord, as they have to experience this time away. Lord, whenever that takes place, Lord, as Vince goes and
puts on that military suit. We pray, Father, that you would, as he puts that suit on, we pray, Father, that you would ride in each pocket. Lord, that you would just shroud him with your presence. Lord, in ways that only you can do. That we just sit back in amazement. It's a God thing. And we ask you, Father, that you would protect him, love on him while he's gone out of our presence. And we ask, Father, for Kendall, that too she would know your presence in her life every day. Know that she has a church family that is supporting her in this time of absence, and knowing that we'll stand by her in the needs that she may have. Lord, give Vince the knowledge and the encouragement and the peace of heart to know that his wife is cared for while he's away. And we pray, Father, that you would work through Vince. Lord, that you would use him for your glory. Place him where you want him. Lord, and give him the courage, as he has so often, that he would stand for you. And we pray this in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And that is a reminder to pray for all of our military as they're away from their families and service of the country, and do keep them lifted before the Lord. And as we move forward, the ministry to the military is just going to expand as God opens those doors and provides that. So continue to pray for our military, if you will. All minds and hearts are clear. I want to ask you, will, to stand again. You're invited to come and join us in the meal that is prepared, and time of fellowship one with another. And we hope that you can stay and participate with us on that occasion as well. And as we dismiss, we'll ask the blessing upon the food, and we hope that you'll come and join us, if you will. Let us pray. We thank you, Father, for this day. Lord, your good blessings, and Lord, your presence of your people as we fellowship together. Bless, Lord, all of us as we leave this place. Lord, that your grace may be found to shine upon us. Lord, that your grace may abide with us every step that we take. That your name may be on our tongues and our lips. That we would proclaim you as Lord every day. In Jesus' name we pray. We also pray, Father, today in this time of fellowship that is yet to come. Lord, the food that is prepared and set before us, that it be used to nourish the physical body, as the Word of God is a nourishment to our spiritual soul. That we may be strengthened together in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen. Praise be unto the Lord.